evening, everybody.
Hello, good evening.
Looks a little bit more normal, don't you think?
Yes.
Yep, do a roll call, please.
Heck?
Here.
Dorsey?
Here.
Willett?
Here.
Westmeyer?
Here.
Bain?
Here.
Manera?
Here.
Lambert here.
All right, now we need a motion to adopt the agenda.
I make a motion, we amend the agenda, adding an item of shared revenue, the cost of resurfacing the parking lot for the senior center slash library to share with the city of Flushing and possibly Clayton Township. And the, I guess I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, sorry. Any other discussion on the agenda? Hearing no other discussion, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, the agenda is approved.
Make a motion, we approve the agenda.
Sorry.
We just amended it.
Yep. Any discussion on the agenda? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No. Approval of previous minutes.
I make a motion to approve the previous minutes.
Second. Any discussion on the minutes? Hearing no discussion, all in favor of approving the minutes, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Minutes. And then approval of the payment of bills listed.
I make a motion to approve the bills listed. I'll second.
Is there any discussion on bills? Hearing no discussion, would you call the roll on the bills, please?
Lambert, yes. Westmeyer?
Yes.
Dorsey?
Yes.
Bain?
Yes.
Heck?
Yes.
Manera?
Yes.
Willett?
Yes.
Now we're going to open the meeting to public comment for items that are on the agenda, which includes you have 3 minutes at the podium. Come on up and have your comments.
Hello, everybody. My name is Josh Colbert. I'm an attorney. I'm here with Dave Black. Caregivers.
Could you say it last night?
Colbert. C-O-B-E-R-T.
Okay.
Yep. I'm a lawyer down in Lansing. Yeah. I have Michigan cannabis lawyers. We've been doing cannabis law for quite some time here in the Michigan. I've been retained by caregivers here in Flushing. Come address the city council. The township. I was here last time as well, and I told the story about Byron Township and Christy DeRubic and how they're still in the courts. It's been 5 years, and they're still at the Kent County Circuit Court, and they've been up and down through the Supreme Court, and they'll probably be back at the Court of Appeals and Supreme Court. We're not really any closer, just like before. So other than that, I want to really address this new draft. And this new draft has in it the special use requirements. I didn't really talk about that before. And with the special use, you're going to require, or it's going to involve, public notification about this caregiver operation. Now, this is an issue that hasn't been addressed before in cases like the city of Wyoming versus Tribune, Uber versus Byron Township, or any of the others. And this really does conflict with the Medical Marijuana Act 2008. In Section 6 of the 2008 Medical Marijuana Act, It requires the marijuana regulatory agency to create a database and to have a database of caregivers. Now, that database by that statute is also confidential, not subject to the Freedom of Information Act. And if somebody divulges information from that list, other than to law enforcement, it's a misdemeanor punishable by time in jail. The reason for that is it was very important to keep the location of caregivers secret, essentially, because caregivers don't want people to know they're growing marijuana for various reasons. People are more likely to possibly rob you if they know where you keep the marijuana, for instance. So that has been confidential. Also, people, because I'm a caregiver, doesn't mean I want my employer to know that I'm a caregiver. It doesn't mean I want my friends or family to know I'm a caregiver. And so it's been confidential since 2008 with the state's database. Now, if we were to create a special land use requirement here and require that information to be published, it's going to really fly in the face of the intent behind Section 6 of the 2008 Medical Marijuana Act. And I think that's an issue that's certainly ripe for litigation in terms of conflict between the two statutes. When I mentioned DeRuiter Byron Township, I'm sure you're all somewhat familiar with that case. That's the preeminent, most recent case involving this issue. But that case is only decided that the issue that presented did not conflict. Not that any other issue would not conflict with the Medical Marijuana Act, Section 6, for instance. And it also doesn't address field preemption, which I talked a little bit last time. And that's why the case is still down at the Kent County Circuit Court to address field preemption. So we still don't know what we can regulate. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Josh.
Michigan chapter. I live in Flint Township, just right down the road from me, not too far at all. Unfortunately, I have to echo Attorney Covert's sentence. This is not settled law. You are trying to establish an ordinance based on law, which is, at this point, hypothetical. You are still looking at DeRuiter going through the courts. That's your primary basis for justification for going beyond the Michigan Medical Marijuana Act of 2008. Just to let you know, I'm seeing three or four different issues here which are potentially litigious. You're really opening yourself up to some lawsuits. Section C2 of the use of primary care, where they shall provide delivery services to qualified patients. The use of shall is a legally binding term. It's very problematic for humans. But let's set aside the language of the act itself. Let's just talk about the character of the community and the messages you're sending to the people that live inside it. What you're saying is that we don't trust you. We don't think that you're a good steward of your own responsibilities. And we're going to regulate you to the point where we get to decide what you do inside your own home. And we're going to do so not without justification of cause. Or we're going to treat you, even if you haven't done anything wrong, like a person who's violated rules, even if you haven't, just because it makes us feel good. The fact is, your community deserves better. There really hasn't been any examples that you can cite of caregivers acting poorly. And the message you're sending to your community is one of intolerance, not one of acceptance. Now, that could affect the way the businesses choose to locate you, could affect the way that people choose to locate their residences, or whether they even choose to move here at all. But I think, more importantly, it affects the reputation and the character of every one of your streets, every one of your lights, and every one of your signs. It's a stain on this community if you pass this ordinance. And unfortunately, I feel like it'll be resolved in the courts and at the ballot box. Thank you.
Thanks, Rick. Right. Good job.
Started drafting this ordinance, I was already in the process of drafting my own township. They kind of wanted me to take charge in this, and they did, because I am both an elected official, planning commission official, and a caregiver. So I have cared for people in this, this community for a long time. And with that, I put forth the effort to draft an ordinance that I believe is bridges the gap here. The main issue that I saw right away was the special land use, as attorney Josh Covert just mentioned a little ago. And so with that, and I don't want to be too redundant on the points he made, but I concur with the points he made. So checking with him and other attorneys, I came to the conclusion that the best way to approach this is by a nuisance issue. Only by a nuisance issue is there a problem. Of course, I understand you may have a couple bad actors, just like every community may have. In fact, this has been a concern of my community as well. So as neighbors brought these concerns to us, the main goal was, okay, if you want to prevent, like, people that, if you want to make sure that people that are coming here, that are caregivers that live here, then just require that they live there. You know, make sure that they live the residence or building, and things like that. Make sure you require up to code things, but don't make it mandatory. Not every home that is purchased or acquired or rented needs a updated electrical system or needs updated plumbing. So these are only if needed. I have a copy of this ordinance. I gave it to my township attorney. He gave, you know, his approval on my draft, and I'd be glad to hand it to you guys as an opportunity to consider a different option. I also have a clause in here which allows for the for an appeal process. Okay, in case, for example, you had an enforcement that was too strict on one of your residents, and you want, and they were going to take you to court. Consideration of clause in here allows for the appeal process before the Board of Trustees. A simple majority of board, majority vote of the Board of Trustees can override a decision by your ordinance. So it gives you a parachute clause. I'm just trying to bridge the gap here and give you folks some cushion. I don't want to see different various townships in Genesee County have different ordinances for people that, you know, cross different lines, don't know what those ordinances are, each one's different, and then each one may have a different case law. It's been going on for a long time. And I think that this ordinance draft is a good way to bridge that gap and not end up in court. So thank you for that. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Eric. Thank All right.
You guys know what? See,
I'll wait till after that. Hello, my name is Robert Dean. I'm 7373 North Seymour Road, Flushing, Michigan. And I do not grow at my property, but if I did, I wouldn't tell you. I have a 110-acre farm out in Chesaning. That's where I do all my caregiving. I also have I'm approved to do 100 acres of industrial hemp. So I've had a hemp license since 2018. And this is the reason why I got involved in medical marijuana. To begin with, 15 years ago.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, careful. That's dangerous.
On the street there. So anyway, that's what got, I had an incurable disease, idiopathic thrombocytopenia plate disease. It was, I was an experimental, same as if I had AIDS or leukemia.
Really?
Yeah. Didn't know, so they couldn't treat. They started taking body parts out, strung down in this. Eric Donald, 15 years ago, said, "You got a track marijuana." I'm like, "Are you crazy? What's marijuana going to do for me? Marijuana? What are you talking about? I am dying." He's like, "I'm telling you, you got to look into it." Well, after they removed my spleen and that didn't work, perfectly good spleen, I looked into it and I started studying. I'm like, they had this in our medicines up until the 30s, 60% of our medicines. Our grandfathers, great-grandfathers, great-great-grandfathers took this. On the norm. This bag's made out of canvas. Our American flag, first one, canvas. Henry Ford built a car, 41, canvas. Wow. We didn't know none of this. They replaced lead and paint. Canvas oil was replaced with lead. Tree pulp. All the trees gone. I'm a hemp farmer, and I'm approved. Anybody in here that owns over 10 acres in Flushing or anywhere else in Michigan, or is next to a farm that's 10 acres or more, I can grow hemp plants that look exactly like marijuana plants. They smell exactly like them, except they're about 10 foot tall, directly up to your yard. No smell, no fence. I got a stick of poster out that says, doesn't contain THC. It looks the same. We got a quarter acre stolen from us. I mean, we're going to, you know, so.
Disappointed.
Yeah, so look into the hemp though, because smells and stuff, that don't matter anymore. In 5 years, every other farm is going to have 15 foot plants growing right next to your house. You got a weed whack around them. My neighbors did. They did 15 acres. It's legal. It's here to stay. It's a $26 billion industry within the next 5 years. We've embraced it. And get rid of the lies. It's been long enough. I appreciate it. Eric, I agree with Eric's track. I've been a caregiver for 15 years. Appreciate it.
Hello, everyone. My name is Buddy Dalton, a local Flushing Township resident. I'm a proud parent, husband, business owner, and marijuana activist. We're here tonight to discuss the merits and drawbacks to the Home Occupations Text Amendment, Draft 4. The original ordinance, called Draft 2 as written, was designed to sever the relationship of patients and medical caregivers by opposing harsh language, making it nearly impossible to comply. After months of working on this together, we have arrived here at Draft 4. This draft is still unsuitable, so we believe a few more tweaks are in order. Please refer and remove page 2, line 2, where it talks about condos, subdivisions, and planned unit developments, because plants 13 through 72 smell no worse than plants 1 through 12, when carbon scrubbers are used and should be allowed. Also, we believe this permit process should be deemed optional. There is literally no reason to inspect a legal medical caregiver. We will follow the guidelines of this ordinance without inspections, as we have been doing since 2008, as voted on by the people of Michigan. Most of us growing as caregivers are completely within the guidelines of our clearly established law and always behaving politely to our neighbors. We hope you shall spend your efforts towards those growers that are operating outside of the medical caregiver program illegally. We are also requesting to be on no list, no square footage requirement, no inspections, no permits, no special land use hearings, and going forward, no more rules when it comes to how we conduct ourselves inside of our homes and on our properties. Being an indoor medical caregiver is to be thought of as a simple activity, not a home occupation. As a citizen, we are not required to obtain a permit for activities such as cooking, watching television, surfing the web, sleeping, washing our cars, mowing the grass, dancing, or gardening. Permits are not required in this case, as indoor growing as a medical caregiver either. Most growers will not wish to comply. And finally, the idea of a special land use permit is unlawful and dangerous. Exposing the name and address of every medical caregiver wishing to cultivate a detached building will bring the attention of the wrong people and may potentially lead to crime or deaths and put our citizens into dangerous situations, making their homes targets and our neighborhoods unsafe. Never divulge to any caregiver by their name, or address openly on your website or in a public hearing, and completely removed any implication of requiring a special land use permit in this rigorous process for type 2 growers. Please respect our wishes and demands. We, the medical caregivers of Michigan, are a good bunch, an excellent part of society, your friends and neighbors, your fellow citizens and taxpayers. Think of us as a peaceful, freedom-loving American living honest lives in the privacy of our homes. We are the same as you and required to live an unobstructed and unrestricted existence in this township and throughout our great state of Michigan. I love Flushing, Michigan, because I really care. It is a place I'm so proud to call my home, and I promise to always protect it. Thank you. Free the weed!
We have founded a board, United Cannabis Caregivers Association. We are in the process of retaining attorneys for the people that could be getting picked on. That being said, I want to give you guys some credit for adopting your last four drafts. I think we've come a long way. Our goal is not to protect the people that are bad neighbors, the people that are over the plant count, living out of the area, gotten houses, you know, blowing smell towards their neighbors. We don't want any part of that. Our goal is to work in unison with you guys to create an ordinance that people are gladly sign up for, and you know, not you know, live in the shadows anymore, but come out and do what they're supposed to be doing per MMA guidelines. That being said, there's some things that I think we might need to change within the draft four. First of all, I want to reiterate the MMA guidelines state that it is not a home occupation. I understand that for it to be some sort of an ordinance, it has to be, you know, titled as something. But again, our goal is to live peacefully in the township. And not spend thousands and thousands of dollars going to the Supreme Court, you know, scrapping over, you know, this and that. Section 6 of the MMA guidelines specifically state keeping our info, our patient's info, where we live, all that stuff private. We do not want any kind of crime. You know, there's a lot of good caregivers in the area that I speak to regularly. And one of the main concerns is nobody's going to sign up for an ordinance if you put all our information out there. I think, you know, to keep the crime down, to keep people from breaking into our homes, stealing plants, whatever. I think that's very important to keep that private. So please reconsider that. Another issue is the type 1 versus type 2. To penalize somebody from using a barn versus the house. Personally, I think it's better to keep it outside of the house. It can be more secure, away from kids. You know, it's very, very much so easy to contain within a barn versus house, versus basement of a house or whatever. And I don't think it's fair to make somebody go into a type 2 special land use permit over that. The usable floor space, I got an issue with the egress windows. I don't know if there's egress windows in the basement, if that counts as usable floor space, or if there's no egress windows, if you can use the entire basement. So I'd like an answer to that so I understand.
You're going over your minutes. Let me just clarify.
Sure.
At the last Planning Commission meeting, they added the basement to your usable floor space. So our assessor would typically only use your square footage of your house as your floor space.
So if there's any egress windows, would that count as usable floor space?
I have no idea. We just they just said the basement. They didn't say
yes.
So if you guys, in theory, you're probably not. I mean, we're kind of splitting hairs here.
Yeah, exactly.
If somebody has egress windows but their basement is unfinished, and let's just say they have 24 plants down there, but they're over the square footage, Could that be considered usable floor space because there's egress windows down there?
That wasn't in the definition of, it just said basement.
Okay.
So basement.
So would a basement be, if you got a, let's just say a 2,000 square foot house.
Yeah.
I mean, you got 2,000 square foot downstairs, that's, is that usable floor space?
25%.
Okay.
Of the basement and upstairs.
Okay, so it would be all included. It would be considered floor space even if it's not considered square footage of the home.
True.
Right? Okay. All right, well, my time's up, so.
Thanks.
Thanks, Scott. Good job.
Thank you. Hello.
I see everyone again. I'm a long way from, you know, back to you, so I'm proud of that, and I'm glad that you did. Been able to make some concessions and rethink some things along the way. It's something that's important. Again, my name is Jenny Lindman. Flushing Township resident, live on Gillian Road, and I don't want to repeat myself too much from the previous meetings, but I would reiterate, of course, that even still at its language, it does conflict with the MMA, and technically won't really be enforceable until there's a court ruling saying that it's. But tonight, I really wanted to talk about the Type 2 Special Land Use Permit. And the process that goes along with it. Now, Mr. Bain, at the last meeting, you gave us a story about how, you know, there were some neighbors who, you know, grew outdoors, and the smell attracted some theft and some issues over there, and it was problematic. And, you know, I agree it can be. But, I want to make you guys understand that by putting Pine River's name and their address out on the agenda, or to go into the minutes, for people to be able to put that and say, okay, this is why we're there. And for any people that show up while the person is trying to apply for the permit, can hear the reason why, which would be, I want to grow a 72 plant for operation as a caregiver, and that's why I'm applying for a permit. And I have a greenhouse or a pool barn. You know, if they do that, they're really putting themselves at risk. They are putting themselves and their neighbors at risk. Because people can come in and say, well, I don't exactly what that person is doing, so I'm going to, you know, damage his property if I don't like it, or I'm going to rob him of his plants, or God forbid, he's away with his family and somebody comes in and takes him hostage and maybe kills them because they want to get to the state. Because you can't do a whole lot of banking with marijuana, you deal in cash, you can't use credit cards, you can't pay taxes, which is another reason why we're opposed to a home occupation. But back to the special land use, what I would like to see to protect Flushing families, to protect the caregiver and their families, would be to simply just remove the language of the special land use permit. If you want to require a permit, I'm not really even arguing against that. I'm saying why not have them come in like they would type one and say, I'm here to fill out, you know, caregiver application, here's my medical card. And specify on the application if they're going to be doing an inside or an outside. That way they know what fee to pay, because you know you can still keep the fee the same. But then and the code enforcer and the building inspector knows what they're going to be inspecting. All right, they're lost by the building side. But it keeps the caregiver safe, it keeps the privacy, it doesn't bring unintended consequences that I know you don't want. You want to keep time out. And this literally just right opens the door and bites it. So I please ask you all to reconsider that.
Thanks, Jen. Good job.
Hello, Ethel Pansy, Flint Chapter Criminalized Racketeering Against Patients. Since statute has no parity with tangible and only can control other corporate citizens, this board must obey the statute before any 333.26423 use definition section 3H acquisition, possession, cultivation, manufacturing, extraction use, internal possession or paraphernalia relating to the administration of marijuana to treat or alleviate a registered qualifying patient's debilitating conditions, as been determined by the state and a doctor, or symptoms thereof. NCL 333-26-424, qualifying patient of primary caregiver, section 4A, protections from the medical use of marijuana. A qualifying patient who has been issued and possesses a registry ID card is not subject to arrest, prosecution, or penalty in any manner, or denied any right or privilege, including but not limited to civil penalty or disciplinary action area by a business, occupational, or professional licensing board, bureau for the medical use of marijuana in accordance with this act, as long as they are within the legal limits on weight and plant counts. Section B gives the same protections and authority and rights to the caregiver, so the caregiver has all those rights as well, as being fully licensed by the state with no other requirements. There are no inferred powers to be assumed by Flushing Township Incorporated. You act as in a jurisdiction. Section 4E, there is a presumption that a qualifying patient or primary caregiver is engaged in the medical use of marijuana in accordance with this act. If the qualifying patient or primary caregiver complies with both of the following, subsection 1, possession of a registered card, section 2, in possession of lawful amounts, you must assume that they are following the act in the letter. Section 4F, a registered primary caregiver may receive compensation for costs associated with assisting a registered qualifying patient in the medical use of marijuana. Any such compensation does not constitute the sale of a controlled substance. The statute states it's not a home occupation. Section 4I, any marijuana and or paraphernalia or illicit property that is possessed and or owned or used in the medical use of marijuana as allowed under this act or acts incidental to this, you shall not be seized or forfeited. Is it just 1% of the voters that they need for a referendum on the marijuana ordinance? In Flushing, that would be like 45 or something. NCL 333-26-422, section 2C, do not quote in the preamble. States do not penalize the medical use and cultivation of marijuana. Michigan joins this effort for the health and welfare of its citizens. You will be limited as causing the opposite of health and welfare, which is injury. NCL 333-26-423. Thank you.
Appreciate good job, Ed. Woo! Nice job. Yeah, I like them words you were using. Those are big words. Good job. Smart guy.
I'm Steve Snyder. I've been a caregiver since April of 2009. I just want to say I feel like, you know, Ed had to say what he had to say because I don't feel like you guys wrote the Medical Marijuana Act. I mean, you wrote right here, Section Section B1, all primary caregivers shall comply with the Michigan Medical Marijuana Act and meet the rules established by marijuana regulatory agency activated, authorized under the Michigan Medical Marijuana and taxation of medical marijuana shall not be subject to the requirements of this ordinance. Then you immediately start talking about a home occupation, which is clearly, you know, not what we are. And then 3, the growing location for the primary caregiver shall be inside an enclosed locked facility. Everybody knows that. Why do you have to put that on here? It doesn't make any sense to me. It makes me feel like you haven't read it.
Looking it up.
And don't, either you don't really care one way or the other, because it's pretty obvious that you guys like where it's your draft board. And it doesn't seem like it's called Resident Medical Marijuana Act. And draft 4, that means how much time has been spent by the people of this township for you guys to basically make a piece of toilet paper. Because none of these rules really apply to you. Nobody has to follow these. If it says a primary home occupation, primary caregiver home occupation, if a primary caregiver or a caregiver is not considered an occupation, then who does that apply to?
Nobody, brother. You're the man. Good job, Steve. Thank you.
Well, my name is Craig Gagne. I didn't come here to speak on this behalf, but I've heard him say several times, how'd you like to have property you couldn't use? I have 5 acres. It's L-shaped. Inside that L is my neighbor that is not a good grower. His pole barn sits next to my house. All year long, I can't even open up the windows. It stinks so bad, I can't open up the window. That air conditioning. I have a park-like setting. I have family come over and all they do is, what the heck is that smell? Now he's got a 40 by 40 pavilion next to me with a split system that's full of plants. He took the garage on the back of his house, that's attached to his house, put a split system in. He now grows in the back of the garage. And the great room between the garage and the front of the house is his processing facility. He has no job. His girlfriend has no job. They have kids living at the house. He has a bounce house business. The trailer's never left the property. He goes to Florida every 3 months, comes back with new toys. And during COVID, when COVID started, we had vehicles coming in with Ohio license plates, Indiana license plates, Kentucky license plates, 4 or 5 people in a car, one person at a time, go up to the door, do a transaction, come back, get in the car, next person gets out. That's what I'm dealing with, and on a private road. So, I smoked pot when I was a kid. I voted for the 2008. I got a lot of people, a lot of friends that smoke pot. I don't have a problem with that. I'd like to give all you guys a round of applause because I don't smell any in here. And that was my biggest regret is when you walk into a store and all you can smell is somebody that's been burning one next to you. Or you drive down the road and go, hey, that house is growing, but they stink.
Yet you're in a room full of caregivers.
Hey, well, that's what I have. I've got one of the bad growers next to me.
Yeah.
And this board needs something like this ordinance. So they can do something for the bad. I don't think they're out after all the good ones.
Statute provides a remedy for guys that are.
Tell them to get a carbon scrubber.
That's my point of view. That was all my right, 3 minutes.
Hey, no talking between each other. Just talk to us.
Thank you.
Leo? All right, there's no other comments. We'll close the public comment portion. And we'll go to unfinished business. No unfinished business, right? And new business, which is the number one is a second reading of our text amendment to the home occupation ordinance. As we have mentioned, several of you have mentioned, this is actually the fourth draft. As it went through various different stages of discussion and writing, I really want to thank Buddy and Jenny and a couple of the others, because you have worked with us. We've had discussions outside of this meeting, which is not conducive to discussing anything. And I think that we've come a long ways in the ordinance from where it started to where it is now. The board has made a lot of concessions and changed a lot of the restrictions, loosened it up to some extent. And it's taken us this long because when we first started, there was no participation. Nobody came to the public hearing. Nobody came to the first reading. Nobody came to the planning commission, to the board meetings, until we got to the second reading, which is what we're having tonight. And it was our decision to send it back to planning to have a public hearing, allow you to participate in the process. We wanted people's input into this ordinance. This is not developed in a vacuum. We rely on a consultant from Rowe Engineering. We rely on our attorney, mm-hmm. who has
read the act,
delved into this much more than what he ever wanted to, and brings it up here tonight. So this is the draft that we have before us. The first reading was approved last month, and we need a motion to.
I guess I have a question for you. Do we publish it in a paper?
It's published after the second reading.
But no, not the ordinance, but the identity on.
Oh, okay. Well, let's make a motion to do something with the amendment, and then we can discuss.
Okay.
I make a motion to approve the second reading of ordinance number 2021-01.
Is there support?
I'll second.
All right. Now, the bill's question, and I've heard this a couple of different times from several people, is there was another municipality that had what appears, from what I had heard, a much stricter ordinance than ours. They had a planning commission meeting for a special land use permit, and they published way too much information. There was way too much personal information that was published ahead of time, that was on the internet, that was available to people. That sounds like it to me, and the clerk is somewhat familiar with the case, and she felt it was more than necessary. We would not do that at all. We would not publish anything more than what's absolutely necessary. And because this is a zoning ordinance, there are certain required steps the township board has to do to fulfill the Zoning Enabling Act, which is really serious. Steve, is there anything you can
add? Yeah, the notice requirements that I think most of the concern was directed to mandated by the state statute that controls the process to amend or grant special use permits pursuant to the zoning ordinance. Somebody brought up the issue of why distinguish between the type 1 and the type 2 and require the special use permit for the type 2. That's the way the ordinance is drafted currently. Possibly take a look at that issue without having to fully amend the ordinance again. But those requirements are part of
state statute with regard to the notice that has to be provided, published, and then specific individuals within proximity of the affected property have to receive notice by mail. So at a minimum, we have to put in what the request is for, special use permit to operate a type 2 home occupation, who owns the name of the property owner, and it would be for a caregiver special use permit. We don't have to provide patient lists, wouldn't provide patient lists, wouldn't publish the driver's license or the driver's license number. The information I outlined would probably be the extent of any information that under the current proposed ordinance would be required if someone applied for a type 2 special use permit.
You see what the danger is?
Does that answer your question?
Isn't that like only a 300 foot area or something?
That's right.
Correct. Yeah. So it's not like the general population.
No.
But you have to publish it. So, I mean, yeah. Anybody reading the publication would know that information. And then you have to provide specific notice by mail.
You will get zero applicants. Nobody
has to comply, but they don't.
Nobody's going to do this. Zero. I wouldn't do it.
Just relax.
Just don't do it, man.
We'll be all right. Just relax. Take a deep breath. Well, man.
What else? No,
I mean, I'm kind of concerned I don't want to see anybody hurt because we're publishing information that other people don't have to have.
Thank you. Awesome.
That's right.
It's a tricky gray area that we've got.
In the particular incident that I was made aware of, and I didn't go back and look at any lists, so I'm not saying who it was. It seemed to me like it was way, way over sharing of information. You know, they did that
any information.
Zero.
So they did it on purpose to embarrass the person. I don't know what the same thing was, but we don't do that. We've never done that.
Just said with
even in a police report, it gives numbers of how many incidents, but sure. It doesn't give any names of who was involved or where or anything about it. No, we don't put out personal information. No.
But Steve is saying we have to under Michigan law.
Well, we don't put out driver's license, social security number.
You put their name and address. That's it.
Yeah. That's all you need.
All you need is a name and address. You put their information.
Quiet, guys. You got to talk now. It's my turn. So, it would only be the bare minimum that would have to be in
there. To you.
And the fuck out of these.
Oh, they're going to get in big trouble.
Planning Commission is the one that would hold the hearing for that. They're the ones that would rule on it, not somebody in the office. We could approve the type ones, which are the simpler things, but if it's a complicated site plan and they have to provide drawings and whatever, then that's got to go to planning.
We don't need that.
The bare minimum is all somebody needs to know where you're at and what you're doing and to come rob you or shoot you.
We can put on our application.
This is crazy.
Quiet. Quit talking, guys. Any other questions about it? Anything else?
I'm with Sherry. I think we need to make it the very minimum.
Absolutely.
That's what we always do. That's what we've always done. We put a minimum there for whatever it is.
Is there any other way we can do this?
Just a name and address.
Follow type 1 permits.
It has to be in a. It has to be in a paper. And it goes on our website.
There's no attached to the name at all.
It's ridiculous.
Instead of a special use, is there another way that this can get done without disclosing personal information?
Specifically, we
without publishing.
Say follows the statute.
It has to be kept internally just within the township and not made.
Well, the individual who said just deem them all type 1 permits.
Yeah.
Yep.
That's the only way that can
probably to mind. It would be a purely administrative function. Someone would apply for the permit, whether it's type 1 or type 2, present the information to the township, and it would be granted. There wouldn't be any need for the public hearing before the planning commission. Whether that's feasible.
Well, what are the pros and cons to that?
The pro from their standpoint is it doesn't require a special use permit, doesn't require notice of the application for the special use permit, doesn't require the public hearing before the planning commission, which typically are, they are subject to the Open Meetings Act. There is an exception in the Open Meetings Act for closed sessions, but I doubt that would apply to a planning commission hearing on an application for a special use permit. So the only feasible way I could see to make it work the way you're suggesting is to eliminate the distinction between type 1 and type 2, deem all the permits type 1, and that would require the township to be comfortable with the administrative determinations on the all of the permits, whether they were seeking what we classify as type 1 or type 2. If you were inclined to consider that, we would still need the safety valve. The appeal would be if the decision administratively made was adverse to the applicant. You'd still want that to be reviewed by the planning commission. The applicant would want that to be reviewed by the planning commission. I don't know. I mean, there is no perfect solution, but the most obvious road to what you're suggesting is to eliminate the distinction between all of the permits for caregiver home occupation permits as type 1s, regardless of whether it's going to be in the dwelling itself or in an accessory structure.
But then after doing that, we would also need to develop some sort of an appeals process for, you know, say, whoever we deem to make this decision, you know, whether or not they get the land use permit, then there would need to be some sort of appeals process.
Always.
Right?
Yeah, there's always an appeal. Mm-hmm.
But then at that point, then you would have name and address published.
Yeah. Well, that would be the applicant's request.
Decision, right, right.
Yeah, and typically it's either myself or the zoning administrator. Those would be the same thing. Well, those are the pros. The cons are exactly the same. You're not notifying the public. You're not making the neighbors aware of what's going on next door.
Good.
You're not having a public hearing, so to speak, where neighbors can come and say, you know, I'm not comfortable with that. So you're putting the decision strictly on me or Dennis as saying whether this is a good idea or bad. That's what I see as the con to it is the transparency that they've asked to have.
That was implied with the Michigan Medical Marijuana.
Yeah. Public is not doing that.
The building inspector would not corrupt the code, you have filters and you have a lock and you're being a good neighbor and not like, you know, filter smoke in your neighbor's yard like a gentleman who spoke.
So what would it take to change that?
Draft 5?
You can't have more than two caregivers who are mandated by law on the HIPAA, right?
Yes.
If there was a change on it, I think there should be a mechanism that there is abuse. You know, like we said about a nuisance if the problem comes.
Well, it's a misdemeanor. If somebody violates the restrictions that are in place, the code enforcement officer could write them a misdemeanor ticket, or the township could
file soon.
Red tag there, perhaps.
I just want to make sure we do enough, but again, the privacy
right
thing.
Right.
I mean, I agree.
It's important.
Yeah, I agree. That's why I brought up before. That's why I brought that point up. There's bad people out there.
Of course.
And they're predators.
Yeah. Of course.
So that's why I brought that up in the first place.
It's unfortunately targeting the good growers when you don't say their name.
Yeah.
Yeah, you need to target the bad guys. Not the good guys.
Considering that we're talking about changing the structure because it runs from the beginning to the end in terms of distinguishing type 1 and type 2. So,
I have another question. The gentleman who brought the issue about the L-shaped property in that. Now, what if we do changes, are we still going to be able to help him if there's a situation like that?
I don't know what's going on. It's the adjoining property. I don't know if that's a medical marijuana caregiver or if that's just somebody growing marijuana.
He claims to be, but and that's the whole issue we're at right now is we don't know how they're operating, how they're functioning. Are they legally operating as a caregiver?
The statute has a procedure.
Or are they strictly
just get a filter.
Putting them all together and just growing marijuana because they want it?
The statute just provides a procedure for
inspection or.
Yeah, well, they
through a complaint. Yeah,
exactly. Yep. And then so either we are aware of it or a neighbor makes us aware of it. Mm-hmm.
We'll inspect them.
Thank you. Yes, that's what I would.
Yeah, the law enforcement has the ability to call Lara and to verify a card number to see if they are indeed a registered patient or not. So that. That should be done in any instance where maybe it's called into question.
It's a catch 22.
Yeah.
Now, I don't really like the idea of publishing either, but then I don't like the idea of one person making the decision and approving
it. Inspector. You got an inspector.
What about outdoor guys?
No, this is our time to talk.
There are no landis. There's no way to have it go before the planning board without publishing.
No.
That's in the inside state law, and it's part of our ordinance, but the state law requires that process under our ordinance.
Yeah, it's a minimal, just like...
Yeah, what's the state law mandate?
The objection I'm hearing is the fact that you're publishing a name and address and notifying, let's say, the world at large, because you have to publish this notice, that that owner is applying to use that specific property as the location for a medical marijuana caregiver.
Right, and
that's not good. That information in and of itself without any more is what they're objecting to, and I don't see any way to publish the required notice without including that information.
You shouldn't.
The thought was, your suggestion was to be eliminated the requirement for the public hearing. Under our ordinance, there is no public hearing required.
You're legitimate. What you're saying is right.
Growing within the dwelling itself, type 2 grows in attached or detached accessory structures. And I'm not sure why the requirement for the type 2 requiring a special use permit. Caitlin had some reason why she felt that was a significant enough distinction to require a special use permit.
Can't you just put something like miscellaneous with the title of the home occupation? So it doesn't state, well, it's for this, for the marijuana, I mean, miscellaneous?
Mm-hmm. If I understand what you're attempting to do, right, I can probably put the words on a piece of paper. Sitting in front of a bunch of people under the spotlight isn't my best time to think. But if you want, this can be done. I just
table it.
I am constrained to try to cobble this together as we're sitting here and have somebody vote on it as a second reading. If we make any type of significant change to it, so.
Yeah, I think that would be a.
Yeah, are we allowed any input or not?
No, not right now. No, just, yeah. We got another shot later on.
No, it's like you can't put miscellaneous. If somebody were to try to, let's say they want to have a daycare at their home, and you notify the 300 foot and then you publish it, they want to know, the neighbors want to know what's going on. They want to make sure that the traffic's not being increased. So we let them know those kind of things too. You can't put miscellaneous.
Well, I mean, I think like the neighbor notices should say what it is because that's their neighbors.
Right.
You know, but I mean, for putting it in the newspaper, that's.
The neighbors shouldn't know. They'll rob you, sir. The neighbors will rob you blind. Man, guys, don't.
That due process requirement providing notice applies to all special use permits, not just the hearing restrictions. What they're suggesting is providing that required notice is going to create problems, not only for the caregivers, but the adjoining property owners, if third parties now have this information and use it for the wrong purposes.
Usually, no.
A lot of the people are sick, and it's embarrassing. A lot of patients don't want to be known either. Who wants to know that they're
your neighbors should never know.
They're sick or failing, maybe. They're doing marijuana. They have cancer. He's dying over there. Did you hear?
If you use carbon filters, the neighbors can't smell it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. If it stinks, knock on their door. Stop.
Can't hear myself.
Yes.
Well, we have a motion on the floor. If you want to approve this one, we can vote on it. If you want to do something else, then I would suggest we make a motion to do something else, whatever that else is. And address it that way.
Saying that vote on this, if it doesn't pass, do something else.
No, we could vote on it, but you could also make another motion that you want to do something else.
Your options in the broadest sense are, one, send it back to the Planning Commission. I'm not suggesting that. You can table or adjourn it at the board level and ask someone, possibly the attorney, to draft some language that addresses the concerns of one, two, possibly three trustees, and then bring it back to the next meeting for consideration by the board. That's an option under the Zoning Enabling Act. It's already had the required public hearing twice at the Planning Commission. It's been here before and sent it back. I don't see any reason that process finally funneled this to the attention of the people who have an active concern regarding the ordinance. And I don't think an additional public hearing is going to get us any more information than we've been provided by the people in the audience. So you can send it back, you can table or adjourn it, or you can vote on it as it is. Since this is a second reading, it's pretty much as is. You can make clerical corrections, editorial changes that don't affect the substance of the ordinance as it was presented at first reading. But if you're considering the kind of changes that are being discussed, this won't go through the second reading. It's too dissimilar from the form of the ordinance at the first reading.
So if this gets turned down, and we say you make a tweak it to where it's applicable, everybody can live with it. It just comes back here for approval for this as a second reading.
No, that would be a first reading.
You'd have to come back as
a first reading.
As a correct. Because the changes that you're talking about are more than just editorial or clerical corrections, there's substantive changes.
So, before we get too carried away here, is there a motion that, is there something that you want to see changed?
I would like to see if you can come up with a way protect the privacy. If there's another way that we can do that, you know, and if you've got some options, when you get time that you can think about this and look up some stuff or whatever you can
yeah,
do,
not
Steve.
Right.
Yeah, that's right.
It's not going to take a lot of time. One in the back of my mind, I would like to talk to Caitlin, and if I can reach an understanding with her, the obvious solution to the most pressing problem that I'm hearing is pretty straightforward in terms of the changes to the ordinance. And then I may call, talk to Bill. I wasn't quite clear on what he was suggesting in addition to that.
Because I agree with Wendy in the fact that it's not fair to put it on one or two people, that it should go before a board. But
well, no, because if we take it to a board, it has to be a public.
That's what I mean. So you're stuck between having it decided by a board, then the information has to be made public, or decided by one or two people to keep everybody's privacy. So it's
Good idea. That's what we should do. Have Fred decide.
The inspector. I'll talk to Fred about this, but if you're making the decisions internally, administratively, it doesn't necessarily have to be one person.
Right.
You could convene two or three township employees, the building inspector, the supervisor, and they could decide. And then internally, you could have a policy that said we'll make these decisions on a majority basis. There will be three of us. We'll review these. And
sounds
like a star chamber.
Exactly how we've been functioning for the last year is myself, the clerk, the assessor, zoning administrator, and quite often Caitlin, possibly Steve, if we need to. And that group, and they're not voting members, so it's not a quorum issue, so we're not violating the Open Meetings Act. We've been doing that on virtually every planning commission decision, is that group has been meeting, reviewing it, and then making a recommendation to the planning commission. But that same process could happen and review their application and then make a decision. I do think absolutely there has to be an appeal process where the applicant, if he's not happy with the outcome, then it's his choice, he has to apply to the planning commission or here, either one, whichever way we want to go.
Fred, I move we table this.
I second. That way we can come back.
By tabling, what are we doing?
Table it to the attorney until the next meeting.
This isn't going to fly.
Adjourn until the next meeting.
What's the difference, Steve?
If you motion the table, it sits on the table until someone affirmatively motions to remove it from the table.
Exactly.
If you motion to adjourn it to the next meeting, it's going to be on the agenda for the next meeting.
But this one is going to come back. It would bring something. You can't, because this is a second reading. So you can't change it and bring it back as a second reading.
No,
this has got to go away.
Right.
That's what I've been saying the whole time. Take that one to the bank. Go away. Yeah, I like that word. Go away.
We'll have this exact ordinance and we can discuss and say, Steve's got this, we want to table this one or scrap this one and do a new one, or
we would come back with a first reading on a different board.
I would rather make a motion to have our attorney look at this and edit the type 2 with some of the suggestions that we come up with tonight to the next meeting.
Bring it back as a proposed
ordinance.
Yes,
for the first reading.
Bring it back as a
new ordinance.
For
so is that.
First
reading. We can do that. Change this into a first reading.
No,
this is the second reading.
Correct. So, your motion is to table the second reading that that's in front of the board tonight. You're making a motion that the township attorney revise this proposed ordinance and bring it or place it on the agenda in time to place it on the agenda for a first reading at the July meeting.
Right.
All right.
I can go along with that.
Let's vote on Jerry's. We can vote on it.
I'll remove my motion.
My second also.
Okay. So I made a motion, but somebody has a second.
I'll second it.
Good job. Good job, ladies. That's a nice board.
Any other discussion on it? We'll have our attorney and others work on this over the next month, bring it back for the next meeting. Okay? Yes.
Okay, Dorsey?
Yes.
Bane?
Yes.
Manerick?
Yes.
Westenbauer? Peck?
Yes.
Meinberg, yes. Willett?
Yes.
This is the never-ending ordinance.
Yay! We did it! Again.
Number two is a motion to approve resolution 2105, a resolution pursuant 41.724, parent 1, to tentative a special assessment district for the maintenance and repair of the Coldwater Road extension. So this Coldwater Road extension has had a maintenance agreement for